this time of worship and praise, God. We just thank you for this time, God, of the saints coming together, people coming to gather in your name, God. People coming together to worship you, Jesus. We don't have an agenda tonight, God, because it's all about you, Lord God. So let it be done according to your will, according to your ways, God. Open up the hearts of the people that are here tonight, the precious people that came out, that they have a fresh word, Lord God, just pouring in their hearts. The spirit of wisdom and revelation would just pour out of the knowledge of Jesus tonight. Oh, Lord God, I just thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do tonight, Lord God. Just increase your presence in this place, God. Let us all just rest in you, Lord God, that we can just enter in, Lord God, that the whole time that we're here, we're just smelling the beauty of the Lord God. Just open up a heaven, God. Open up an open heaven, Lord God, in this place, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do tonight. We just thank you, Lord God. We just talk to you, Holy Spirit, now. And we just say, have your way through the testimony, through the worship that's going on here, God. And through the message, Lord, that you would heal somebody tonight in the room from a broken heart, Lord God. That you would give a word of acceleration in their ministry tonight, God. That we ask you, Holy Spirit, to have your way. That you would empower somebody tonight, God, in the mighty name of Jesus. That demons would flee. That you would deliver, God. That you would come and deliver somebody here tonight that needs deliverance from their past, from their present. Lord God, if fear is in the room, I cast it out in the mighty name of Jesus. We bind the spirit of fear right now because God has given us a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. So we thank you, Lord God, that people are resting in your presence, God. We thank you, Lord, that there's a river here, that there's a river of life flowing right from the throne room of God, flowing right from our beings here tonight, that we're together as the body of Christ, as the saints, as the bride of Christ tonight. God, we thank you, Lord, for a word. We thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do. We just welcome you, Holy Spirit, again and again and again, that we submit, that we're willing and yielded vessels. If there's a word of wisdom that comes forth tonight, a word of knowledge, Lord, we're going to move in the Holy Spirit here tonight. We're going to move in the Holy Spirit tonight. If you have a word, awesome. We just thank you, Lord God, that you're setting people free, because when you know the truth will set you free. We thank you for your love, for your kindness, Jesus. We're going to talk about the blood of Jesus tonight like we talked a few weeks ago. We talked about the foundation of Christianity. The foundation. We aren't Christians without the blood of Jesus. There is nothing that we can do to step in to Almighty God's presence without the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. So I thank you, Lord God, for tonight, what you're going to do in and through this place. And this was so amazing tonight. This is so amazing. Like, the same blood songs kept playing. We were hearing them over and over. They were supposed to go to the next song, but, you know, God has his way. So we were supposed to be singing about the blood over and over tonight, you know? Is that awesome? Yeah, Weezy comes up to me and she goes, I think you keep playing the song. I was just entering in. I didn't even realize, you know. So we just thank you, you know, for coming out tonight. We have a little different agenda tonight. Weezy gave us a snapshot on launching the School of Ministry. 2 years ago, I was on the road to nowhere and I was driving home. I was working full time. I was leaving the School of Ministry, and the Lord spoke to me about an equipping center. And I was like, Lord, I'm working full time. I'm going to school. I'm in the prison ministry. I have a life group. I have all these things. But he showed me what it was going to look like. And I said, okay, Lord, in your timing. And then a couple years later, here we are now, you know, believing God for a building, that this equipping center would not only be Bible studies and schools and church and deliverance ministry, when people would come in broken, We would bring prostitutes in that needed to be set free. We would bring the people downtown that were poor. Maybe there would be a van where somebody could bring them up and people could be set free by the power of Jesus. This is what kind of equipping center we're talking about for Berks County. I mean, it's way beyond the spectrum that I can even imagine, but Weezy and I have been praying we're gonna live outside the box.
Amen.
Because we gotta step out when God's called us to do something and believe He's gonna meet us. So tonight was the first night that all you precious people got to come and hear about a building, and Weezy's believing it's going to be handed to us. So hallelujah, praise God. Somebody's going to donate a building, the equipping center. And for 13 years, I've been sitting in the presence of God. For 13 years, God's been downloading the word in my heart. For 13 years, I've just been so in the presence of the Lord, knowing Him. Because if we don't know Him, we can't love Him. We can say we love Him, but if we don't know Him intimately, we can't love Him. We might think that we love Him with some kind of love, but the love that God has for each one of us, when we come to know Him intimately, know every facet about Jesus, and we could study Him every day from morning till night until we see Him face to face and we just scratch the surface.
Amen.
That's how much there is to know about Jesus. It's like, that's all I want to talk about. But of course, I like to talk about where He was when He walked on the earth, so we would have a deeper revelation of the pain and the suffering and how precious this man was, fully God and fully man, that if we could just study out the foundation of the blood of Jesus from Genesis to Revelation, we would honor Him, we would love Him more, we would be compelled to serve others, to love others, we'd have mercy on people that it's hard to have mercy on, because it'd be one drop of blood. One drop of blood pushes back all the gates of hell.
Amen.
One drop of blood can heal anybody that needs a healing. One drop of blood. We gotta honor the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And these six sessions that I'm having here is about going deeper, deeper, deeper into the simplicity of the gospel. It's the deeper. Yes, we're going to hit foundations in the revelation. We're going to talk about the Holy Spirit and fire, what it means to live for Jesus. We're going to be talking about some parables. We're going to be talking about a lot of things that when Jesus walked. You know, when you read a parable, it was for that time. When you read the same parable, it's for the time now. And when you read the exact same parable, it has at least three dimensions of the time to come. But when you sit with Jesus, He reveals that to you. It's not that you just read a parable and it's like, oh, that happened back then. So we're going to be getting into all that. So my heart was burning, burning about, I want people to know Jesus passionately and intimately. Weezy read the mission statement. I want to equip the saints in the church to get ready, to be prepared, to be able to walk in power, the power of the Holy Spirit every day. No matter what we're doing, we want to walk by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That's what we want to do. We want to walk by the power of the Holy Spirit. When a tragedy comes, we want to have ourselves equipped to be able to know what to do in that time. How do we have weapon of warfare? What is it we have to do? You know, God has everything in the Word of God of what to do, how to overcome. Do you know He says only those that endure to the end will be saved? That verse alone. Only those that will endure to the end will be saved. What about Tracy, that Revelation, Romans 10:9 over here? No, John 17:3 says everlasting life is to know the one and only true God and His Son, Jesus Christ, whom He sent. That's eternal life. We're going to know Him now, and we're going to know Him eternity forever. Like I always say to the Lord, because how we live for Him now is how our position's going to be when we rule and reign with Him through the millennium, through the new heaven and the new earth. So the CEO of the company that doesn't have any time to know Jesus intimately and passionately, I don't know what their job will be in heaven, what their role will be, the authority that they're going to have there. I want to be as close to Jesus and be doing as much for Him as I can do when I live in this next, in eternity, in the millennium. If people would know that's going to church every Sunday that there's so much more to this walk with God than going into church, sitting down and trying to, you know, think, okay, well, I got to walk away and maybe do a random act of kindness this week. The deeper that we get into the Word and get in to know Him, the better we're going to be to walk this earth, and then we can, all the hope in the entire Bible is about the hope to come, that we're standing waiting for Him. Do you know He says He's coming back for those that are earnestly waiting for Him?
Amen.
For those who are waiting for Him. We are waiting for Jesus to come back. And that means that we are every single day thinking on Him. What is the first and the greatest commandment? Don't you love Jesus, how He calls it the first and the greatest? In other words, there's the first commandment, there's the second commandment, and then there's all those commandments that are in the law, back with Moses, which are all relevant today, also, those Ten Commandments. But what I will tell you is that if the loving God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, all our strength, all our affections, all our thoughts, loving Him, we can't do it in our own strength.
Amen.
Only through the power of the Holy Spirit can we love Him with His love that He pours into our hearts. Romans 5:5. I must bring this up every time I preach. That God pours His love out in our hearts by the power of the Holy Spirit. We are walking around not with our love, it's His love. When He activates His love in our hearts, we do things way before we were saved that we would have never done. We have a spirit on us that's forgiveness. You know, we go to Him and we ask Him to help us. But I'm telling you that when we walk in the power of Almighty God, and that's what He has given us by the power of the Holy Spirit when we get born again. We don't have a regular life. Our life, we are a new creation in Christ. We are a new creature in Christ. The old has gone. He doesn't clean us up where we are. We are new in Him. We are the light of the world. We are the salt on the earth. This is what He's done. But people have to get equipped to know who they are in Christ. So that was just the beginning about this school. So anyway, that's not the message. That's just the school. That's just the beginning. So let me just give you like 10 of these. I know that you have them, but I'm just going to talk about this for 2 minutes, because I've talked long enough on this. So the essentials of the Word will be for you if you want to grow deeper into who God is, who Jesus is, how much He loves you, and the amount of love that's so incredible that He's poured in us that we can pour out on others. This school is about our identity in Christ. Just the simplicity of who are we in Christ. We're not the regular person that's next door if they're not a believer. Who are we in Christ? Our life in the Spirit. That's the name of my life group. Life in the Spirit. That means we are completely different people. But I'm going to get into detail and get into this incredible treasure. We are rich people when we are born again. We are rich, rich, rich in God. We're only taking the Holy Spirit with us when we go. That's it. Everything that we did here on earth is written down in heaven. You will find out if you decide to go to this school or come to revivals. But I will tell you that you will find out where you are going, what God is looking for you now on this earth, getting you ready to what you're going to do when you go there, when you go to heaven. It's going to be so amazing. Spiritual warfare. We're going to have a class on spiritual warfare. Everything the Bible says about spiritual warfare, you won't walk around anymore burdened and with your head down, and I don't know if I can do this anymore. God will give you the strength that you need through spiritual warfare. Amen. And it's amazing. There's prayer, there's worship, there's praise, there's decreeing the Word of God. The the word of God in our mouth is a sword. And when we speak the word of God, Satan wants to keep us silent. The Bible says he wants to keep us silent. But when we speak the word of God with power, and we have weapons of praise and worship, look out. And I will show you in the Bible a few, when we get to that course, a few powerful stories that the people that hardly had any resources but had praise and worship unto God versus a whole army to take them out. Because when we praise and we worship, I'm going to tell you what, God hears it, he sees everything, he hears our praise, and things are changing. There'll be healing and restoration, a class on healing, emotional, physical. We don't have spiritual healing because we're perfect in the spirit when we're born again. So it'll be emotional, our soul wounds. There'll be prayer. We'll start out with 20 minutes of worship, 25. It's going to be 3 hours long. You're going to have 2 hours of teaching. I'll be doing a training manual. That won't be right away, but you will have sheets that will end up one being in a training manual. So what you get in those amount of hours, you will take home and you will pick it up. It'll be somewhere where you have it close by, where you can go in. And when you're empowered in the class, and you're empowered, you will be able to take it outside the classroom. You'll be so empowered, you will be able to walk every day by the power of the Holy Spirit. The second coming of Jesus Christ, I'm going to teach a class on that. The essentials that you need. This is just the essentials. I can't do the whole Bible in 10 classes with 2 hours of teaching, because we're going to start out with worship. We're going to have 2 hours of teaching. That's going to be questions and answers, and then prayer. On the last class of the 10 classes, there'll be an impartation that takes place, you know, and a commissioning to what God has called you to do, that when you walk out after 10 weeks, you'll be transformed, even to a higher. I'll be transformed too, because as you said, spend time, you know, the transformation is from glory to glory, and it never ends.
Hallelujah.
You know, yes. So we're continually being transformed, and none of us are going to arrive until we get there face to face. So the power released in worship and prayer, that's going to just be a whole session in itself, because that is such, people don't realize it's not just Sunday morning, 15 or 20 minutes. We got to worship, and everything is seen. And every time we worship God, there's something else that's going on in heaven. Because every time we worship with God, heaven is also worshiping. So we're coming together with heaven and worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. It's amazing. The presence of God will just be incredible. And in that class, I'm expecting for miracles to happen, because we're going to be doing some worship. Peter, after like, you'll be coming along for that one. So anyway, encountering his presence, that's my heart. Loving God with all that you are. When you love him and you obey him, you know when everybody shouts out that John 8:32? When you know the truth will set you free. Well, the truth is lined up with obeying him. It lines up. The truth of obedience toward the Lord changes your life. That's the joy and the peace he's talking about in Romans 14:17. That the kingdom of God is not eat and drinks. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Yes. And then Romans 15:13 says the same thing. It's the joy and the peace. So we as Christians, if we don't have any joy, then we got to look inside at the thermometer of our heart and say, are we loving him with everything we have? Because obedience, you'll never get to enjoy God's presence if we decide to not obey him. His word is so beautiful. The treasures in the word, it's not burdensome, it says in 1 John chapter 5. It's not burdensome to follow Jesus wholeheartedly. We've been crucified with Christ. Hallelujah. We no longer live. Hallelujah. But it's Christ that lives in us. And the life that we live now, we live by the faith in the Son of God. Because he died and he gave himself for us. Wow. Picking up his cross. You know what that means? Picking up our cross. We die to ourselves. We get to come into the glorious kingdom of what it means for the glorious kingdom's pleasures and treasures. You won't encounter them unless you choose to make the
number one thing in your life, loving Him with everything you are. And then you'll know where to serve. Because in that secret place, He gives you the desires of your heart. In Psalm 37:4, He says, as I delight myself in Him, He gives me the desires of our hearts. And the desires are kingdom desires. We need kingdom mindsets. We can't think like the world. We got to come together as the bride of Christ and have kingdom mindsets. So encountering His presence, we're going to talk about how we encounter His presence in a more deeper way in every situation. Not just in a church service. Knowing God intimately, that's my number one. Our inheritance. So many people are walking around haphazard. They don't even know their inheritance here on earth, let alone know their inheritance, what they got when they get there. People would live differently if they knew their inheritance. Because guess what? We're not all equal when we get to heaven. Nobody wants to hear that one. We're not all equal. I only started this walk at 43. I'm like blown away at Gabriella that's here last 2 weeks ago taking notes. The treasure, the crown she's going to have when she follows Jesus and loves Him, and how He's going to anoint her with His word and His power in her life is going to be incredible. But I only got to start at 43, but I'm going to run my race like Paul did. I'm going to run my race with everything I have and bring as many with me as I can. So real peace and joy, the joy that just flows out of you when you obey the Lord and you know Him intimately and how you walk with Him. There's a joy and a peace that is so amazing. And then you're going to come into your divine purpose. Will be at the end where there'll be a commissioning. There'll be an impartation. The essentials of an eternity. I'll be talking about that. All that we have when we get there. And then prayer and proclamation, which has been my weapon, along with praise and worship. But my prayer, the declarations that we make is the most powerful, along with praise and worship. But if we get the Word of God, Satan's trying to keep people out of the Bible. You got a couple verses, that's good enough. But when you get in the river and you start learning the Word of God, and you're in the car driving and something happens, or you get a phone call, you can say the devil has come to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus came to give me life more abundantly, overflowing to the full. Or 1 John 3:8, Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Or God loves me with an everlasting love. I belong to the King. He's my bridegroom. We got to know the Word of God so we can start decreeing it. Because Satan will beat us up if we don't use what God has taught us in the Word to do. You'll barely get in, it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 8. You'll get in barely, but you're not going to have any rewards. Not that we're living for rewards, because guess what the rewards are? We can't even imagine what they are. They're eternal rewards. They have nothing to do with the plaque on the wall or the extra $20 or the $1,000 you get. That's not the kind of rewards you're going to get. The rewards are going to be eternal rewards. It's going to be a place for eternity to spend with Jesus. Why is anything worthwhile here on earth? People need to know, have the knowledge, and then decide how much time do they want to know the Lord. So anyway, this equipping school is going to be launched at the end of January, if God has His way. I've been going around into spiritual happenings within 2 or 3 hours away. Different ministry groups, places that I've been invited to speak, and it's only increasing. And then I have these revival meetings that are already in place till the end of the year. But I don't know, I keep saying, God, where do you want me to go? The equipping school's been on my heart because I just feel that, you know, in church, we have 52 Sundays if you meet every week. And then you have, of course, you know, everything that goes on with the worship, and you have your announcements, and you have that, and you might get 40 minutes of the Word, okay? So if you do the 40 minutes times the 52 a year, you really don't get that much of the Word. And if they pick a verse and then just decide to just talk about this one verse or something, but this essential school, and I'm not just saying it, I'm saying if people are going to be hungry, they're going to want to come. And if not, that's fine too, because I want people to get in the Word of God themselves and let the Holy Spirit reveal Jesus to them, because that's the role of the Holy Spirit. I want people, and if people can come to a revival like this and say, I'm getting hungry for God, so be it. The people that want to be, just have a call in their life, or they want to go deeper in the Word, and they're like, and this is going to be an accelerated 10-week class, then go for it. But, so anyway, thank you for hearing all that. But I want to call up Judy Loper first. I know this is a little different. She had a radical encounter with the Lord at the last revival. So I asked her if she could give us a snapshot of what happened. Come on up, Judy.
I have to stand here for a minute. Okay. I'm a visual learner. So I want you to know I did not have the worst seat in the house. When we were praying and singing and worshiping about the blood of Jesus, I was right at the foot of the cross. It was wonderful. It was awesome. It was awesome. And you know what? Our life is a journey. And many of us stay at the foot of the cross. Many of us stay on our face at the foot of the cross, crying and suffering and not hearing what God has for us. But where Tracy is standing is revelation power. It's resurrected power, okay? So how do we get from there over to here? Well, you go through the burial, and you go through the oil and the anointing, and then you live in resurrected power. Hallelujah. God is good. How much time do I have? I want to read to you.
We're moving by the Spirit tonight.
I want to read Psalm 45. My heart is stirred by a noble theme as I recite my verses for the king. My tongue is the pen of a skillful writer. You are the most excellent of men, and your lips have been anointed with grace, since God has blessed you forever. Gird your sword upon your side, O mighty one. Clothe yourself with splendor and with majesty. In your majesty, ride forth victoriously in behalf of truth, humility, and righteousness. Let your right hand display awesome deeds. Let your sharp arrows pierce the hearts of the king's enemies. Let the nations fall beneath your feet. I praise God for his word. It is just incredible, and I am as passionate of it as my dear sister Tracy. Over in Isaiah 21, verse 5, it says, get up, you officers, oil your shields. The Greeks would oil their shields to keep them from getting brittle. And they would do that over and over and over again so that the arrows would not pierce the shield. We have a shield of faith, but are we holding it oiled? Are we holding it steady? Are we holding it strong? The last time that I was here, right in this spot, Tracy had asked me at other times to pray for different ones that would come forth for prayer. And that day, the Lord sometimes tells me to sit still. And sometimes he tells me to get up. And that day, he asked me to sit still. So I was sitting there just praying for what was going on at the altar. But then two of my dearest friends who are now in India, serving the Lord on a missions trip, Sharon Gruber and Nancy Kaiser, they came up for prayer, and Tracy said, let's pray for them. Well, my heart was right there. I had to jump up and pray for them, right? So as I was praying for them, the anointing of the Lord just fell on all of us so heavily that I couldn't stand. I went to my knees. I was overcome. I love being overcome by God. I love being overcome by Him.
That's awesome.
And as I was overcome, Julia here had a word for me. And it was a powerful word. And it released not only a freedom to walk in the calling that God has called me to, but it released a spiritual permission to do so. And I praise God for that word. I got up the next morning and I wrote a prayer. And I'd like to read it to you today, if I may. And after I wrote this prayer, I sent it to a few people. I sent it to Weezy, actually. And when she wrote me back, she said, in parentheses, this looks like chapters in a book. I've been writing for 40 years. I've been writing journals. I've been writing partial books. And none of them have ever come to completion because something has always stood in the way. And that was maybe 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. Since then, I've written 5 chapters, and God has just downstreamed into me like never before. So I'd like to share the prayer with you, and may God anoint each of you to keep your oil on your shield, and to stand strong with the sword that He has placed in your hand. We may not all have the exact commission as someone else, but you are unique to fill the gap that God created you to fill. And don't let the enemy tell you differently.
Amen.
I praise you, Elohim, my strong Creator God. You have formed me in your image, and you've called me according to your purposes. The battle's been long and heavy, and I've pushed through hard. I've fought the arduous fight and given it all I have. I've poured out as a drink offering before you, El Emanu, my faithful God, and you alone sustain me in your strength and might. At times I felt like throwing down the sword in the dust and leaving it there. I've desired to just walk away and leave it for someone else to pick up. But you, Elohim Kedoshim, my holy God, have called me to walk a new land, and I will not fall back. I will not give up. For you are the one, El Nekamoth, who avenges me, sustains me, empowers me, and breathes new life into my being. You are the one, El Roy, who sees me and calls me friend. You call me your beloved, and you walk within me, before me, behind me, and beside me. You are the one who wears the victor's crown, and I pledge my undying devotion to you. You call me anew and afresh to come and receive a new sword from you. You have more for me, and so I come to be restored, equipped anew, to go out yet again and face the giants. But this time I go out in greater power, greater anointing, and greater strength than ever before, for you, Emmanuel, are ever with me. I have come completely to the end of myself, and you, Jehovah Uzi, are my strength, equipping me in your almighty power. Esh Okla, my consuming fire, you are truly my breath and life alone. I will not be discouraged or let the weariness of the battle get the better of me, but I will continually rise up in your joy and your power, for you, Jehovah Mekadishim, are the Lord who sanctifies me. What lies ahead is larger than I could imagine, but I know you have a lot in store for me that is truly magnificent. So I come, Lord, I come. Impart to me all that I need to face yet another journey, yet another giant. I know I am precious to you, Jehovah Tzedekhu, my righteousness, and that you love me so very much as I do you. My circumstances do not define your love, but rather they shelter my focus on thee alone, and they draw me into your holy presence, your sustenance and your grace, your mercy, peace, love, and joy. So I come. I declare and decree no weapon formed against me will prosper, for you are my high tower, Jehovah Metzudathi. I declare and decree my mind will be the mind of Christ. My mouth will be an instrument of your peace, and my helmet of salvation will guard every lie of the enemy. I declare and decree that your Holy Spirit within me will be an all-consuming fire, and the belt of truth will bind my armor. I declare and decree the righteousness of Christ is my breastplate and guards me against the arrows of the enemy. I declare and decree Jesus has shod my feet with the gospel of peace, and many will come to salvation because of my obedience to your call. Jehovah Megan, the Lord my shield, I hold strong and steady the shield of faith, and I proclaim the great works that you have done. I pick up that sword, the word of God, and I take the land before me in the name that surpasses every other name, Jesus the Christ, my living Lord.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Well, that's just, I can't even, I mean, that's just awesome. I didn't realize, Tracey has been telling me that, you know, that you had this experience, and I'm like, all right, you know, and, but when you just said what you said, and what, it's just like, wow, you know, you really, it was awesome. I didn't realize how much of an impact, you know. So praise the Lord.
Amen.
I mean, we all need to walk in that place. We all have that calling in all of us. You know, God's calling all of us to walk in that place of really martyrism. of laying ourselves, like she said, the cross to the revelation and resurrection power of Jesus Christ. And we all, we all have that, you know, and it's a matter of all are called, but few are chosen, you know, and the ones that are chosen are the ones that are willing to lay it all down for Jesus Christ. So anyways, I'm having a women's meeting, a women's group. Tracey is coming. I'm hosting Tracey at my house. When?
The 19th of November.
I'm forgetting now. My mind is somewhere else. Yes. November 19th at 12 o'clock at my home. And she's going to be ministering on the bridegroom and the 10 or the 5 wise virgins, having the oils trimmed and with oil, being filled with the Holy Spirit, and being prepared for His return. And as we meet Him, and this whole bridegroom, lover of my soul, of what we're going to be ministering on that Saturday at my home. So it's from 12 to 3. I live in Exeter Township. We're having a brunch, so you know, whoever wants to come, you know, are welcome. I have invites here, and it's, unfortunately, we just have it for women, not men. But I just thought it'd be an intimate time for women to come together as sisters in the Lord and have that intimacy together, to be prepared and anointed and whatnot, however Holy Spirit wants to lead us. And so, if anyone's interested, I have the invites here, and that's it.
Okay. Amen. Thank you, Julie.
You're welcome.
I know Frida has just one more thing, and then I'm going to get into the message. And this is just something we're being moved by the Spirit. So go ahead, Frida. My sister. 5 minutes. Go ahead. We're getting the words tonight about the blood.
We will understand belief in the last days. Last days is it will be glorious days. In the same time, it will be hard days. Glorious days is because we will have revival. Everybody talk about revival. We want revival. Before revival come, it will be hard time. It will be hardship. Church will be persecuted. I grew up in Russia. I born in Russia in a time of when church was persecuted. And if I will ask any of you if you know what it means to be persecuted, you don't know until you will be persecuted. Holy Spirit says, I will come to every house. I will put in a test every soul. Without power of Holy Spirit, nobody will make it. I don't know if you believe in this. I will repeat. Without power of Holy Spirit, nobody will make it. But I tell you, many of us, many of Christian people don't know what it means, power of God. I prove you by the word of God. Remember Peter. Peter was sitting in a boat with Jesus. Storm come. They wake up Jesus and said, Jesus, look, storm's coming. We're dying. Help us. Peter saw by his eyes how Jesus stood up and say, be still, and storm stopped. Peter saw how Jesus walked in the water. Peter walked in the water too, but in the end, he denied him. Peter was in a mountain with Jesus, and Peter heard from Almighty God, He is my beloved son. In the end, he denied him. Peter saw how bread multiplied in God's hand. Peter saw how Jesus healed sick, cast out the demons. In the end, he denied him. Why? No power of Holy Spirit. When I read these stories about five wise women and five unwise, and when I read this, I was young, and I asked Holy Spirit, what does this mean, oil? What is big deal, they don't have much oil? He told me, this is power of Holy Spirit. All problem of these wise, unwise five women, because they don't have this power of Holy Spirit. And if you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit, it's impossible to have power of Holy Spirit.
Amen.
To have power of Holy Spirit, you must be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And many of us, many of Christian people, they're not baptized and they don't know what it means, power of Holy Spirit. One time Holy Spirit told me, when I was at church, Holy Spirit told me, did you see these 3,000 people? You will never see them again. Why? Because they will be great falling away. He said, I will shake this church and church will be empty. We need power of Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We cannot live with power. We have no power to stay against demonic power without power of Holy Spirit. When I was thinking about this, what Holy Spirit told me, many times I cry out to God and say, what can I do? How can I help these people? According to Ephesians chapter 4, God put teachers in our church. He put teachers to equip us, to we may grow spiritually and help others. I'm in a prison ministry, I see hundreds of people, they cry out to God, they're going to hell. Who can help them? Who will go to help them? God needs people who can go to and help them, save these people. This is why today we need people. And thank you, Jesus, we have people. We need godly leaders, we need anointed teachers. And thank you, Jesus, we have today godly leaders and anointed teachers. And I would like to tell you and every leader in this room, please help people in your group, equip people, help people be strong in the last days. And with this, when they will equip us, when they will train us with this power, we will go and help and save the lost.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is we got some hungry people in this room. So I'm excited to continue this message on the blood of Jesus. So Father God, we just thank you, Lord God, as this word goes forward, Lord. Lord, that you just accelerate this message, God, and that people will have the true knowledge, the power that's in the blood of Jesus. Even when we talk about him, God, shedding his blood, the power that's available in this room as we speak about the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name. So, I'm really excited that everybody came out tonight. I know there's a football game on. So all you people, I guess, aren't home watching the football game, but with today's technology, we can be taping it. So, praise God. So, I wrote up all this other stuff about the school. I'm going to skip it. The next time I come, I'll go back to that because we got to move forward here. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, I suggest that you write scriptures down because I just keep going with them. I'm going to be doing some teaching tonight,
My teaching sounds like preaching, but I'm going to be teaching because I'm going to be reading some powerful verses that you want to take in. And when you leave here tonight, go home and take and look at what you wrote down and look at it again. And God will increase His power, His presence, and the revelation knowledge of who He is. Okay? So, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2. Paul, the great apostle Paul that suffered, that wrote a lot of his messages in the Bible in the prison, where he was beaten and shipwrecked, rejected, starving, beaten with rods so many times. He went through as much as the Bible reveals to us in the New Testament after Jesus. I mean, Paul endured. What was it? There's something in the Bible that I say to myself, what is it about these people that are enduring to the end? Paul running his race, keeping the faith, eyes fixed on Jesus. No matter what he was going through, he never threw the towel in. What was it? In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, he says, I know nothing except Christ and Him crucified.
Amen.
We can't ever let that leave our hearts. When we start looking at everything else, as far as ministry, church, your life as a Christian, and you negate on your knees, fasting and praying, coming before the Lord, seeing what He did for you. It all starts with all the blood. The blood in Revelation chapter 5, if I'm going to have time, I'm going to just read a bunch of blood scriptures to you. Before the foundations of the world, Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit had a conversation. They knew ahead of time nobody could go through their life without turning from God, without the empowerment and the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, what Frieda didn't say, that she left it for me to say, is the only way that any of us can have the Holy Spirit and then the Holy Spirit in power is that Jesus had to say yes to the cross. If He wouldn't have said yes to the cross, none of us would have the Holy Spirit. And God knew that none of us could walk through this life like Peter. He was hearing Jesus. But what I'm going to talk about tonight, the very first verse is when he said, Jesus, I will die for you. I will never leave you. And right after that, it's Peter disowned Jesus. But the only way you can have the power to overcome, the power to live for Jesus, the power to love God, the power to say no to the worldly pleasures is having the Holy Spirit and power and getting in the Word of God, knowing Jesus intimately. And as you sit with Him, He will release more and more and more. And there's never a time where you're not going to get more revelation. It never runs out. It's a river. He's the river. It never runs out. We're just going to keep knowing Him as long as we live here on earth. And then when we get to heaven, the Bible says we're going to keep knowing Him there. We're going to never stop learning revelation knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's how much knowledge there is about Him. That's why our church services and our time, you want to get in the Word and learn who He is. The enemy, he's always trying to keep people blinded. In 2 Corinthians 4, I'm just going to quote, I don't have time to read. But in 2 Corinthians 4, it says that the enemy, the god of this age, small letter G, has blinded the minds of unbelievers that they can't see the glory of God, the glorious gospel, or the glory of God, verse 4 and 6, they can't see the glory of God that's in the face of Jesus Christ. It's all about Jesus Christ. Everything is about Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit's first and main role of the Holy Spirit here on earth is to reveal Jesus to us.
Amen.
So when you get in your intimate time, He reveals Jesus to you. Now when you, right before Easter every year, I just had this little thing I do it all year long, But maybe a month before, I read from the time that he was in the garden, right at the last discourse, and he was speaking to the disciples in John 17, 14, 15, 16, and 17. All those four chapters is where I fell in love with the Lord, with everything that I am. But there he was. He knew he was going to the cross. It wasn't like if you're going to the cross and like all of a sudden something happens to you and it's terror or something evil. You didn't know it was going to happen. See, Jesus, he used to look in the Bible. There wasn't a Bible, but he'd look into the scroll and see himself. He knew what he was going to do. It wasn't a surprise to him. And the kindness and the love of this man that walked on the earth, we need a deeper revelation of who he is as the Son of Man here on this earth, what he came to do. So Paul, that overcame, what did he say? I know nothing but Jesus Christ and him crucified. In other words, he's saying to everybody, don't forget the blood of Jesus. Even though tonight, it just kept singing it over. It was supposed to go to other songs. I mean, we were supposed to listen to those over and over. That's what we listened to. It was so amazing. Okay, so 2 Corinthians 4:4, 1 John 5:19, it's another one. It says, we are children of God, but the whole world, the world meaning everyone that's not a child of God, is under the control of the evil one. You want to know why we have all this that's going on out there? It's because there's a kingdom. It's the power of darkness and the power of God's kingdom. We've been translated into the kingdom of light, it says in Colossians 1:13. We've gone from the kingdom and the powers of darkness into the kingdom of light of God's dear Son, Jesus Christ. So what I'm saying is we have to live with kingdom mindsets. If we don't live this earth, and no matter what happens, whoever was sharing tonight about martyrdom, about giving everything, like I said, that we are crucified with Christ, we no longer live. Everything is being written down. There's books written down of every single thing from the time you got born again is written down in heaven, even a cup of cold water that you would give to somebody that was thirsty. Everything. So I wanted to read Psalm 63, 1-8. I don't have time. Go read it. It's absolutely amazing. And Psalm 40 will reflect the passage I'm going to go to in just a couple minutes. And so just write those down, and that will be really great. I want to go to Matthew 26. There's so much in here, and I'll give you a snapshot of what we're going to read about. But I never know, like when I study something out, like Matthew 26, Matthew 27, Matthew 28, I mean, so amazing. Like, you want to know about the last week that Jesus walked on the earth is so powerful in the Bible, in the Gospels, and then the 40 days that he walked on the earth, telling his disciples what exactly they needed to know. I've given all power and authority to you to trample on serpents and scorpions and all the power of the enemy. You know, I mean, this is our mandate. We lay hands on the sick. If they recover, God's the one that's responsible. We got to step out. So I didn't know what to do. What should I talk? You know, I wanted to just talk about everything. I wanted to just capture all of you for about 5 hours and tell you all of it. But I don't have that time. So I picked Gethsemane. And I've been eating this and talking back to God about it. What it was like prior to going to the cross. Now, he knew what was going to happen. So think about in your thoughts, like what that would be like if you were chosen. Like if you were the Son of God that laid down all divinity, come to earth, you've been reading about yourself since approximately 9, 10, 11, 12, whenever it happened, but now you know you are going to the cross. Now Jesus kept telling the people, I'm going to be crucified and I'm going to be rejected. I'm going to be crucified and I'm going to be rejected. Does that sound familiar for us? We're going to be crucified and we're going to be rejected. That's what's going to happen with us. But Peter just got denied the Lord's Supper. He just sat around the table. I want you to just get into your imagination of how this was. He was sitting around the table, loving on these disciples, knowing that somebody was going to betray him, knowing that somebody that was breaking bread with him was going to betray him. But Isaiah 53:10 says it was the Father's will
all before the foundations of the earth for Jesus to shed his blood. Jesus did not die because the six legions of soldiers came to get him and they captured him. This was the will of God before the foundations of the earth. This means I want you to know that he could have said no at any time, according to Psalm 91, any time to grab them up, grab him up, and he'll say, no, I'm not going through with it. At any time, it was his free will. Now I'm talking about the will of God. I'm talking about our will. Like how our will is, like think about it. We have to lay down our will to do God's will. But this is the will, and I'm gonna connect it to Hebrews 10. I hope I have the time, but I'm gonna connect it to Hebrews 10, the will of God on Jesus' life. So here we go. So right before we get into this is chapter 26, verse 36. I'm going to start at 35. But Peter declared, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the other disciples said the same. So like Frida said, there it is. There's the verse. 36. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. The stage is being set. The stage is being set. He knew at this point. He got in Gethsemane. And a side note is I was there when I was in Israel. It was the most, I was mourning and crying and thinking about him there, being on his knees. It was the most powerful stop for me. You know, Gethsemane. Because I thought at that point, it's our destiny. I mean, at that point, when you go read how all he wanted was somebody to pray for him. Do we all know we need people to pray for us? Mm-hmm. He just wanted them to stay awake and watch and pray. The Bible says in Matthew 24 and all over the Bible, that's our mandate. Watch and pray. Watch for the signs and pray. Watch and pray. Jesus told them to watch and pray. This is also, like I said, this is for them, but it's also for us. It says, he was sorrowful and troubled. Jesus knew he was going to the cross. Do we ever read these verses and go, oh my, I wonder what that was like for him. He got up on that cross for me, and there he was, right before he was captured by the soldiers. He says, then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Now another version, I think it's Luke 22. I picked Matthew for a few things they say in here, but the angels came and strengthened him. He was sweating drops of blood. And there's a whole scientific thing that when you sweat drops of blood, you must be really nervous. Think about it. He knew what the crucifixion was like. He saw what all those people were crucified. He saw what kind of horrific treatment the Romans gave. He was walking on the earth knowing what he was going to do. You know, we could talk about Christ crucified and for the cross and how that was. What about prior? Thinking about it here. It says, going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground in prayer. Like he was coming before his Father like we do. My Father, if it's possible, may this cup be taken from me. Jesus was like, is there another way? I'm getting close. Maybe this cup of judgment and wrath, maybe there could be another way. He was fully God and fully man, but laid all his divinity down. Father, is there another way? When somebody says to you, is there another way to heaven? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and there is no other way to heaven. It's the only way in. When Jesus was on his knees, is there another way? If the Father didn't let his cup of wrath and judgment take, why do we think we can get in any other way than through the blood of Jesus? It's the only way. There's no other way. If somebody says, well, this person over here is a good person. Well, this person over here has been in church. But this person over here is doing this. No, we have to come through him. It says in 1 John 5 that our life is through Christ. Our life is that we might live through him. Now notice what it says. We might live through him. He's in us and we are in him.
Then he returned to the disciples and found them sleeping. Could you, yeah, this is a, now look, go deep into this verse. He found the disciples sleeping. He's saying the disciples are going to be sleeping. Arise and shine, your light has come. Don't sleep. This is the end times. We need to watch and pray and wait for the second coming. He said, could you men not keep watch with me for just 1 hour? This is prophetic. Mm-hmm. This is prophetic. Don't just read it for this. This is about us. For just 1 hour. Can we pray for just 1 hour? Are we sleeping like the rest of the disciples? 1 hour. He's right. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. Jesus is saying that if we don't watch and pray, we're going to fall into all kinds of temptations. God wants us to be set apart, to live for Him, to walk with Him, to be a beacon of light, to walk in the anointing like Peter. When he rose up, when he was walking by, people were just laid out because the anointing was so strong. That he's a human being, Peter. God has so much for each one in this room. And I know there's at least 7 or 8 in here that I know that are radical lovers of Jesus Christ with everything that they have. And God wants to use you in what your calling is. And Satan wants to shut you down. But when you get up and you get your weapons of warfare on, God will bring it to pass. Because we all go through the test. Here we go. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. The spirit's always willing. The spirit, when it says walk in the spirit, that means talk about him. Walk with him. Pray. Get the Bible out. Worship. Lay hands on somebody that's having a bad day and encourage them in the word. Our flesh is weak. Our flesh has nothing to do with this walk with Jesus Christ. Our flesh has nothing to do. If we just wait a whole day before we get with God one way or another, we're walking in our flesh. And we will fulfill the lust of the flesh if we're not walking in the Spirit. It says the Spirit is willing, but the body is weak. And the only way we can become strong, the strong body of Christ, the bride of Christ, the people of God, the family of God, is the more we walk in the Spirit, the more time we spend with Him, the more we walk out this life in God, that's when our flesh will start obeying the Spirit of God.
Amen.
That's right.
He went away a second time and prayed the exact same prayer. My Father, if it's not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it. He's drinking the wrath of your sin and mine. He's drinking the wrath of your judgment and mine. If you are not born again in this room, you do not have any of these promises. If you are born again, born of the Spirit of God living in you, unless you're Gabriella's age, she might not be held accountable at that age. I don't know. But what I'm saying, you do not want to leave here tonight if you're not born again, born of the Spirit of God. Nobody enters the kingdom of God, Jesus said it 3 times, without being born again. It says, for this cup will be taken away unless I drink it. May your will be done. Now I want to connect this to Hebrews 10 before I end. Okay, when he came back, he again found them sleeping. Sleeping, 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 preoccupied and sleeping. Because their eyes were heavy, so he left them and they went away once more and prayed the 3rd time. And Jesus said the same thing. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go, and here comes my betrayer. That was what he was in. Just zoom in. I don't have the time to talk about what it was like for him to be there. I'm going to take you to Hebrews 10, but he was in there sweating blood when they came to him and 600 soldiers came, he knew it was God's will for him to go to the cross. But Peter was still not getting it. Peter said, not my Lord. He took a sword and cut one of the soldiers' ears off. Who do you think got rebuked in the room? Peter got
rebuked in the Gethsemane. He said, what am I starting here? In other words, do you not understand? I told you over and over, I must be crucified. This is what he told him, but Peter still wasn't getting it. So there God was, he at that moment, he was like, I'm all in. Mm-hmm. Jesus was strengthened. He said, I'm all in. What part are we all in? Mm-hmm. What is it going to take for us to be all in? Yeah. All in. Right. All in. All in. Go to Hebrews 10. We're going to end with this. And then we're going to do prayer. Nobody leave here, even if we have to step outside, whether people are down or we're here and we're doing whatever. Don't anybody leave here if their soul isn't locked into heaven. Because times are getting crazy. And you want to be saved. And then you want to be filled with power. The next two revivals, I'm going to talk about everything about the Holy Spirit. The next two. All about the Holy Spirit. Get everybody that you know, because it's going to be 2 hours of the Holy Spirit and then two more hours of the Holy Spirit. Just who he is, well, how he empowers us is so amazing. Hebrews 10. I had so much in here in Hebrews 9. Read 8, 9, and 10 for yourself and your world will be rocked in Hebrews. Hebrews 10. We're going to start with 1 and I'm just going to go down here. It says, my title says, Christ sacrificed once for all. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming. The law is just, it's all prototype going toward what was to come, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifice, sacrifices repeated endlessly, year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. In other words, all the blood, even when Jesus was walking into Gethsemane that day, he was in Jerusalem. He could see the blood that was like a stream coming out because they were just sacrificing. Passover was coming. They were sacrificing animals. He was walking, seeing that blood, knowing his blood was going to be shed. Just imagine what it would be like. Fully God, fully man, but laid all his divinity down, knowing he was the Son of Man. If it could, would they have not stopped being offered? For the worshipers would have never been cleansed once for all and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins, because guilt was broken at the cross. Guilt and shame, no matter what you went through in your life, it doesn't matter. It's under the blood. When you say, I love this by Jesus is famous. A guy, he always says, come before the Lord, confess your sin, and push delete and keep going with Jesus. Okay? But those sacrifices were an annual reminder of their sins. It never could take away the blood, take away their sins. But it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. Impossible. Listen, he had to shed his blood. If people negate the blood of Jesus in their own hearts when they come before God in worship and not think about what he's done, you will never encounter him in a greater glory like you do when Paul said, I know nothing but Christ and him crucified. Verse 5, therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, listen to this, eat this verse, sacrifice and offering you did not desire. This is Jesus talking to the Father. But a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased. So all that time, they were offering day and night, day and night, day and night, going through all those rituals. None of it mattered to God. He said none of it. It was all a prototype and a foreshadow. So people could see the importance, like I talked about last time. Nobody came before God without the blood. And we cannot come in boldly into the throne room without the blood of Jesus. I am marked by the blood. So when God looks to me and I pray, he can see I am marked by the blood. He can see that Jesus lives in me. He can see that Jesus lives in you. You have every right to go boldly into the throne room and ask God anything in your time of need. Because Jesus shed his blood for you. Not because you're special. Not that you think you're holy and righteous. Or I think I'm holy and righteous. There isn't anything that we can do to enter the throne room of heaven except through the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
And this might be elementary, but let's get it on our mind. This is powerful. This is the deep of the scripture. This is the deep. Watch. Then I said, here I am. Picture Jesus going, here I am. He was on his knees. Is there any other way for us? There is no other way. I'd be crucified with Christ. Romans 6, when we go in that tank, we are buried with him. We are buried with him. Ever how that looks like to heaven? You are buried with him. When you come up out of the water, you got the new life in Christ. There's a spiritual awakening that comes inside with water baptism. It's one of my biggest things. When I get where I'm going to be baptizing people in water, it's going to be a worship service. It's going to be adoration to Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then they're going to know what they actually did when they got in the tank, besides a confession. Yes, it's a confession. But you've got to know what takes place when you get water baptized. It's a spiritual awakening that happens. It's the other dimension that we have by being water baptized and filled with the Spirit. If Jesus did it, why would we not want to do it if we're a Christian?
Amen. That's
right. Sorry, I'm yelling. Sorry. Okay. Watch. Then I said, here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will. Oh God, can you imagine? I have come to do your will, oh God. This was Jesus, what he had to do. We're living sacrifices, it says in Romans 12. We're living sacrifices. We abide with the Lamb of God in John 15. He's going to release all these spiritual treasures and these spiritual pleasures and the joy and the peace that comes from the kingdom of God. Are we interested? Are we interested? Do we just want our ticket to heaven? Or are we interested? So, and he says, first he said, sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings, you did not desire, verse 8, nor were you pleased with them. He said it twice, although the law required them to be made. That was all there, preparing for the future. Then he said again, here I am, I have come to do your will. It's twice now. He set aside the first to establish the second. And by that will, we have been made holy. We have been made holy. See, we've been made holy through the blood of Jesus. I can't go to another verse, but it says that his blood cleanses our conscience. Like, when I got born again and surrendered and I looked up to see him, when I thought I was going to die of leukemia, and I looked to see him, and he came in the room by his spirit and gave me this encounter, I thought, my God, I could see that I needed a Savior. Mm-hmm. My God, I needed him. I needed him. It was the first time in my life I said, I need Jesus. I need him. I was going through just ritual. I need him. I knew for the first time I needed him, and not for healing. Not for healing. I wasn't even thinking about that. I needed him to save my soul.
Amen.
And before you have that revelation that you need him to save your soul, there's no other way. Your life as a Christian will be boring and bland. You have to know the need to have him. You have to have the need to want to know him, that he even gives us, that we can come before him, that he wants to sit with us like Mary, and like Mary that poured all she had, like we sang tonight, that he didn't just die on the cross and then we wouldn't be able to encounter his beautiful presence. But he's given us so much. And so what is the will of God for us? The will of God for us is in Mark 8, and maybe we'll do it the next time. So God, in Jesus' name, I just thank you, Lord God,
for everything that you did. I thank you for the testimonies. I thank you for these precious people. I thank you, Lord God, that your blood is flowing through this place, because the Bible says the blood is still speaking today. Your blood, Jesus, is still speaking today. It speaks a better word than Abel. And I thank you, Lord, that we've been purchased by the blood. It's I that no longer lives, but it's you that lives in us. That we've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. That we've been purchased. We no longer, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 6:19-20, God, it says that we've been bought with the price. We've been bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We no longer belong to ourselves. We are no longer. He is our master. He is our Lord. He is our bridegroom. He's coming back for those that are waiting for him.